Right, Aki Kareem for BBTV. I am delighted to be here with former pro boxer, turned trainer, Mr. Mick Jennings. Firstly, mate, happy new year. And I guess are most of the lads back in the gym now then?
Yeah, cheers, Aki. Same to you, mate. Yeah, all the lads are back in the gym now. So we're back to full training with the pros in the mornings.
It's been a frustrating time for everybody. All coaches have got their own different way of going about, dealing with the situation. What have you been telling your fighters about taking over and staying active and things?
I mean, to be fair, the lads that we've got in the gym, they're pretty experienced. So they all know the ins and outs of the game. We're lucky that way. It's only like Mark Jeffers, who's young, 22, you know, but Mark's one of them kids what you've got to kick out of the gym. So we're lucky, really. We're lucky we've got good kids in, and they all know that any point they could get the call up. Look at Jack Cullen last time out against Doherty. You know, he just got the call and he accepted the fight and went on and won it. So, you know, as bad as it is, it could also bring some good opportunities for the lads.
Yeah, that was a good opportunity. He took it with both hands against John Dock, who was an up and coming prospect, and he'd done the business in a great fashion. You must have been really proud of him that night.
Yeah, we was, you know, because he followed the plan, like to a T. You know, we was made up with him. We worked on different things in the gym, and he went in there and he did what he had to do. You know, he got the job done. We were proud of him that night. He did really well.
I guess it does highlight the fact you just made there about taking opportunities, doesn't it? At the same time, sometimes fighters are getting call-ups at very short notice, which is also obviously a disadvantage as well. How do you sort of manage those expectations, and what's your thoughts on that balance?
You've got to look at the pros and cons of it all. I mean, obviously, depend on it. If it was a young lad and he got offered a fight, what we thought, listen, you're in no matter what happens, if you get beat here, you're knackered sort of thing against a kid what's not the greatest. Where you'd sooner put a kid who you've got, you know, a lot of expectations from. You sooner put him in with someone who's decent, because if they get beat, they can come back from that. Where if you put him in with a kid who's, you know, 50% record and he gets beat, there's not a lot of places for him to go. You just got to weigh the pros and cons up. What's it worth, you know, and what sort of situation is it going to put me in if I get beat? What sort of position is it going to put me if I win? So there's a lot to look at, but 9 times out of 10, you get them pretty much right if you've got half a brain.
Between you and Dave, you've got half a brain between you, haven't you? So it's all right.
Yeah, well, I have done about that, Dave. Yeah, you know what? We're a good team. We both look at the pros and cons between us, and we speak to the lads as well. You know, they're all good lads in the gym, so there's no one in the gym that you couldn't say, right, listen, we don't think this is the right fight for you. You know, let's give it a side step. They all understand where we're coming from. They know we've got experience, so they do listen, to be fair.
Well, you're becoming a hotbed, really, for middle, super middle. People must be, you know, relishing the prospect to come in sparring with you. You've got everything you need there in-house. Tell us a bit about all the lads in the stable and just give us a little bit of an overview about where we're at with the lads and, you know, what a bustling gym at the minute.
Yeah, well, I'll start with Mark Jeffers, who's the youngest. Mark, he just signed with Kevin Murray. I managed Mark up until 10 fights, but only reason was doing that because he turned over when he was 18. So we wanted to make sure that he was handled properly. You know, he weren't getting chucked in with anyone. We didn't want him to be chucked in with. But now it comes to a time where I probably can't get him the fights what Kevin could, or someone, or Steve Woods, or someone like that. Do you know what I mean? So we just signed him over to Kevin, and Kevin's sound. We can speak to him, you know, on a daily basis. If I wanted to phone Kevin up now, he'd answer the phones, and he's got contacts with obviously Frank Warren and Eddie Hearn. So we just thought we'll put him with someone else now, and they can do the work rather than us having to do the, you know, the phone calling and yeah and no's and all the rest of it. So with Mark, just looking for opportunities, really. Hopefully he'll get a couple of fights this year. He can sell tickets, and he's improved a hell of a lot. He's a good prospect, to be fair. Then obviously we've got Mark Efron, last fight with Denzel Bentley. I thought he was doing well up until the second round when he got caught in the eye, and to be fair, it was a good shot what he got caught with, and you know, we couldn't let him go out for any more because his eye was completely closed. Mark wanted to go out, but we you know, we're not in that sort of game where we're looking for people to get hurt. We look at trying to defend the kids. We want them to have good defense. So why send them out on the off chance? Yeah, he could knock that kid out in the next round, possibly. Do you know what I mean? But it's what could it do? His eye came up that fast that I thought it might have been eye socket or something like that. Luckily, you know, Matt went to hospital that same night, and then he had to go back the day after he got it x-rayed or whatever they do. And it was just swelling, but it was bad enough for us to see that, you know, it's not fair to send him out in another round and get caught, because Denzel was throwing that right hand and catching Mark because Mark couldn't see anything coming. So now for Mark, it's just a matter of waiting for dates. And we've been told there's a possible date in April, just waiting on confirmation. And obviously with everything what's happening, hopefully he can get back in and get a good win and then get himself back up there. But he's in the gym every day. Very dedicated is Mark. He's very dedicated. He's 100% boxing. So that's with Mark. Jack Cullen, he's back in the gym. He's just been away over Christmas. He went to Dubai with his family. You know, he deserved a rest as well. He deserved a bit of a break. So he's back in the gym now. Jack's a good kid, willing to learn. He wants to learn, to be honest with you. He likes coming in, doing the technique sessions and stuff like that. Again, he come off a good win against Doherty. So hopefully, you know, he'll get a good fight off the back of that. I mean, Eddie Hearn likes Jack. Jack does a lot of tickets, so obviously when we can start doing open shows again, Jack's got a good following, and you know, Eddie could build him up into something. I think he could anyway, because he's got a lot of potential as well, Jack. Then we've got Scott Fitzgerald, who's back in training. He's back on his diet. He's lost a lot of weight actually. He seems to be fully committed again. He's, you know, the demons that he had, seems to be able to handle them properly now. You know, we all know he had different issues, mental health problems and stuff like that, but he's been in the gym and you wouldn't think he was any different to any of the other kids in there. He's on the ball sort of thing. So, yeah, that's it, isn't it? Mark, Jack, Mark, Scott.
Is Jack Arnfield back in the gym, or is that just something I saw a while ago?
Yeah, Jack's back in, but again, you know what, that was... Jack, it was mad because he was supposed to fight John Doherty at first, and then
what happened
there? Jack's appendix bust. So when that happened, Jack Cullen got the call, and he accepted the fight. So we'd already been working with Jack Arnfield for Doherty, so we had a good idea of what he was going to be doing, sort of thing. So that's why we took the fight with Jack Cullen. But Arnfield, yeah, he burst his appendix. Came back in the gym and then got COVID, so he was off for another 2 weeks with that. So yeah, I feel sorry for Jack. He's not had much luck lately because he's desperate as well. He wants to fight. He'll fight anyone. Keeps saying he doesn't want a small fight. He wants to test himself, sort of thing. It is a shame. I do feel sorry for the lad.
But what was his experience like with the bare knuckle, Mike? I've not spoke to him since he done the bare knuckle. Wait, has he come back a slightly different fighter because of it, or was it just a bit of an experience?
I just think he did it because obviously he lost his license, didn't he, due to whatever he was doing outside the game. But he lost his license, and he's a fighter. And Jack is. He might not look it, but Jack's a very tough kid. He will box anyone, and he's got a lot of grit. He's one of the toughest lads I know, Jack, actually. You know, even when he's in there, if he gets caught with shots, it doesn't faze him, sort of thing. So, obviously, he couldn't box, so he said, I'm going to do a bare knuckle. So, he went off and done his own thing, trained for a bare knuckle fight, and he won, didn't he?
Yeah.
And I think he was going to do another, and then decided against it, reapplied for his pro license back, and he got that back. So, as soon as he got that back, he was back in the gym, but he's had a run of bad luck, to be fair.
Well, it's good to hear that he's back on track. You know, you probably can gear as to what I'm going to ask you next. I mean, when we arranged this interview, it was a few days ago, and you know, there was nothing on the horizon. But since then, Brian Rose has announced to come back, and he's been sort of,
with Scott,
saying that this will be a good fight. Yeah, with Scott. I mean, what do you have you seen all that, and what do you think about that fight?
And to be fair to Brian, he's looking for a fight, and Scott's a good name. So and also he's going off the back of Preston Blackpool, which if it was in an open show, it would do a lot of tickets. And you know, fair play to Brian, he's just looking for a fight. And if he did get the Scott Fitzgerald fight, and it wasn't an open show, he'd get a few quid. So I can't blame Brian for doing that. And to be fair, it'd probably be a good fight for Scott to come back to. You know, it is what it is. We're just the trainers, and obviously the managers will phone us up and say, listen, do you want this fight? Do you want that fight? So we've not been, no one's mentioned that fight to us yet. But if they do, then fair play, then we'll decide what we're going to do then. But I think they're looking to get Scott out maybe beginning of March, something like that. So, but we're not too sure. We're just waiting on everyone's in the same boat at the minute. It's a bit frustrating, just waiting on dates. I know Eddie's. He's in a, he's going to announce five dates. I think it's from the middle of February. I think I've seen that on his Twitter or Instagram or something like that. So maybe Scott will be on one of them.
I mean, to be fair, fighters do deserve to get paid, and they need each other to make some money. Do you feel, I mean, that is a good fight, that Scott and Fitzgerald and Brian Rose, both good lads. It would probably sell a lot. But do you think Scott needs maybe a tune-up? He's coming back after a bit of a layout. Do you think he needs something like that to just sharpen himself up?
A tune-up before Brian.
Yeah, or just in general,
Do
but
you mean?
yeah, a tune-up before Brian,
Oh.
yeah.
I mean, listen, he's had a lot of time off, so yeah, you know, maybe a 6 or an 8 rounder would be good, but it doesn't always work out that way. So we just have to see what the options were, and obviously, if Brian Rose got offered to us, then we'd sit down, talk about it, and decide. But to be honest with you, nowadays as well, it's not as much as it's like when I first managed Mark Jeffers, I had to say yeah or no on certain opponents. Nowadays you get offered opponent, listen, this is who you're fighting sort of thing. So it has changed a little bit. So you know, if we got the call and said right, your next fight's Brian Rose, then that's who it is.
Fair enough, fair enough. And that's good to hear anyway from your side. I think that's really interesting. Just in yourself and Dave, mate, as coaches and trainers and people who manage a stable with a lot of young fighters and some more experienced as well, and all really good fighters, competitive fighters. How do you manage to keep all the egos intact and keep everyone sort of working together well?
Well, obviously, once this lockdown's finished, and you're allowed to come up, and you'll see that there is no egos in the gym as a team. You know, when they're in as a team, sort of thing. Obviously, when they're outside, they may be different. But in the gym, we all have a good laugh and just get on with what we've got to do. They know when they're in the gym, it's work time. But we have the crack as well in between. So they're all every one of them's good. They're all good lads. We get on with all of them. You know, the nice kids. Like I said, in the gym, whatever they're like outside, you know, I don't really know that well. But when they're in that gym, they're all nice lads. They come to work, and they know that we're the boss as well. You know, they're not. If we had to, like two of them this morning in the gym, they got 10 press ups for talking, and when they shouldn't have. They understand. You know, we're having the crack with them, but they know we lay the rules down, and they follow them. And fair play to them, because that just shows that they have got trust in us. And that's what we need as well. And I've told lads before, listen, you come in here to listen to what we have to tell you. If you don't want to listen to us, I won't have any qualms about you getting your gear and going and finding a gym and listening to someone else. You come to listen to us, so give us your time and listen to us, basically. It's pretty straightforward. If you don't want to listen to me or our Dave, don't come. Simple as that. Go somewhere else.
Fair enough. That's quite an old school mentality as well. I've been talking recently to a lot of retired. I enjoy speaking to retired fighters, and yourself coming up in that golden era, of course, at the Colliers and Mostyn, working under the likes of Brian Hughes, for example, as well. Do you think that old sort of old school apprenticeship you had serves you now as the trainer that you are?
Yeah, definitely. We learned a lot from Brian. Like I remember kids coming through when I'm saying if you don't listen to us, what I don't mean by any chance, listen, I want the lads to question us. I want to be questioned about things that we're showing them. I love it. I love when the lads ask me a question about why would you do this? Why would you do that? I really do, because I know that they're switched on, they're turned on, and they're listening to what I've got to say. What I mean is when you do tell them something and they're not doing it or not trying it, well, what's the point? That's what I mean about that. We're open-minded, and you know, we're always there for the lads to talk to us about anything. It's when they don't want to listen that's what I'm getting at. As far as like the apprenticeship from Brian, I remember being at the gym, and Thomas will probably tell you, Tommy McDonough, and that some of the kids what came through them doors, like you think, Jesus, he would have been a good kid. But Brian knew, you know, what sort of baggage they brought with it. And Brian couldn't be arsed with all that. And at the beginning, when we first started training, like obviously we started training the amateurs at first. And when one amateur left us, we was like, oh shit, why has he left? What are we doing wrong? Is it us? Is it, you know? But as time goes on, you know, lads come and go. And like I said, the lads that we've got in the gym now, they're all good kids and everything, but the lads do come and go. And I still ask the lads now, even Scott, Mark Jeffers, who's been there as the longest now, Mark Jeffers and Jack Anfield, I still ask him, he's still enjoying it? He's still enjoying what, you know what I mean? Because I want to know, I want feedback off him, because as soon as him talked to us about something that was going wrong, rather than just getting up, packing up and firing off without telling us a question, ask us a few questions. If something's not working for you, as soon as him tell me. And then I'm open-minded and I don't pretend to know everything. So if the lads do communicate and tell us, like, listen, we don't think we could do with a bit of this or we could do with a bit of that. And if I've not got the answer or I've been lazy, I think, you know what, fair enough. But if 9 times out of 10, if they do say, well, we need this, I say, well, we're not doing this today because you've got this tomorrow, or you're sparring this, or we've got Pat, you know. So as long as there's good communication in a gym, they normally do well.
Yeah, as you say, you've got what a crop of talent you've got in there. Real, real, real deep crop of talent. Just a final one, Mick. You know, obviously you're a brother team, you and Dave. Now, sometimes, like, families in boxing, they get on really well. They do. Sometimes they don't. It can become a bit awkward. Why is it that you and Dave work? Because ever since I've known you guys, you've been a unit.
Just probably because we've probably got the same sense of humour and stuff. Do you know what I mean? Like, our Dave's one of my mates, you know what I mean? I could go to the pub with our Dave and have a laugh with him, sort of thing. Our Dave will tell you, like, he's learned a lot off me, but I learn things off him as well. And sometimes I might be a little bit softer on the lads and our Dave will be a little bit harder on it. So it's got its twos and fro's. Like, our Dave, he's good at, he does his own work, our Dave, on the fighters that they're fighting, you know, what they've done and stuff like that. I'm pretty good at doing, like, coming up with a game plan. If their opponents throw this, and this shot, I'm pretty good at, like, well, you could defend that, come back with this. So we just work well, to be fair. We've both got our pros and we've both got our cons. And, you know, his pros probably make up for my cons and vice versa. Yeah, we just, I don't know. We go in, we have a laugh, make a few brews and stuff like that. It's what we like doing. We love it. You know what I mean? So what's not broken, don't try and fix it.
Fair play, mate. Fair play. Well, it's always good catching up with you. I think at some point as well, we'd do a look back at some of your career highlights as well, aren't we? Like, I do another one, maybe look at some specific ones, mate. You had some great nights in the game, mate. Great nights.
Yeah, cheers, Aki. Anytime, mate. You know, just give us a call and I'll always answer anyway.
Appreciate your time, mate. Thanks a lot, Mick. Take care. See you soon.
In a bit, Aki. See you later, mate.